one language and majored in sociology at UCLA. Basically, this young lady can kick your ass, act like she doesn't care, and explain to you in English and Japanese why it is a product of our society and the networks and institutions as to why we behave the way we do. And of course, afterwards, you're going to ask for a selfie and get an autograph because this lady played Katana in the Suicide Squad. Oh, but let's make some noise for Karen Fukumura!
Hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Kia ora, welcome.
Hello.
Konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa.
That's all right, darling. How you doing?
Really good, really good. I'm loving New Zealand. I love it here. I came here Thursday morning and been to a couple spots here and there. Cathedral Cove, Hobbiton, Polynesian spas. It's been a fun time.
What was your favorite?
I think my favorite was Putaruru.
Has
anyone read it? That's probably the best any of our guests have ever pronounced the Māori word ever.
Yes!
Apart from maybe Jason Momoa. But, you know,
oh, okay. He's a Hawaiian. But it's beautiful. So fresh and so clean water.
Whoever's got the laser pointer, stop it now. I will end you. Or obviously the other way, she will. Just rude. So, if you've got a question for Karen, please, you know the drill? Pick up a line in the aisles there. We've got our helpers with their blue capes in the way. What? That's Sanjay. And Bibbs.
Hey!
So if you've got a question for Karen, please jump up there, or I'm just going to sit here and talk to this fantastic woman myself all day, and you know I can.
What does your necklace mean? We all got necklaces carved for us.
So this is done by Dane Pingy from Wellington. He's a good friend of mine. So my one was basically to represent protection. So I sat down with Dane and we had a session of spiritualization over a beverage. And basically, we were just getting to know each other, hanging out. And he said that he gets from me a warrior spirit who likes to protect those of us that he protected. But that's what my particular koha means, my kawi. But he's all the guests here.
Yeah, I got one that was shaped like a heart.
Yes.
Yes, so I'm guessing it means love.
Yeah.
I'll take it.
I mean, there's more to it as well, but the card is probably the man to tell you all that. I can message them on Facebook and find out for you.
Yeah.
We'll sort that out. Right, do you have a question here for Karen?
Anyone?
Oh.
Yeah, stand up, Karen.
First question of the day.
There we go.
I'm really sorry about this. This is completely off topic, but I'm actually hoping you can help me find my girlfriend. And this is not a pickup line, I swear.
Do you have a girlfriend?
Yes, I
do. To look for her.
I'm trying to see if she's here at Armageddon Expo. And the reason that I'm asking you is because I'm pretty sure she did some stunt up for Margot Robbie. And you might know her, Colleen Duran is an artist or illustrator for DC Comics. Are you familiar with her at all?
No.
Okay, so could I please just, alright, if my girlfriend's in the audience, can you please either raise your hand or meet me? Crazy. She's making me chase her all over the planet, it's terrible.
Oh my goodness.
Okay.
Is she here? She's not here?
Anyone in the audience?
What's her name?
Colleen Duran, that's what she goes by.
Colleen?
Yeah.
Well, the lady currently using the name Colleen Duran, one of your boyfriends apparently is at the front.
One of too many.
I'm guessing she's using a fake name, son.
Okay, no, cool, just me, you're alone.
Just one thing, Armageddon can't get any weirder. thanks.
I hope you find her.
Do you actually have a question?
Yes, my question.
Is your name Colleen?
No. I just wanted to know how long were the days, like how many hours were you going to be on the set, especially for like the fight scenes?
So, at the beginning of shooting, we shot most of our out-of-studio scenes on the streets of Toronto. And those were all night scenes. As you may know, David Ayer likes to shoot in the nighttime. He's not really a happy-go-lucky, sunshine, rom-com kind of guy. So, most of our scenes were night shoots. And And it was good in the beginning because we would start shooting right when the sun fell, and then we could stop shooting when the sunrise came. However, when we're shooting indoors in a studio, they don't care about sunrise or a time limit, so they just kept going and going and going. But it was so much fun, you know, just sharing that time, and even the downtime where we're not really shooting and they're setting up shots, we got to hang out with the squad members and just eat dinner together and hang out in our trailers. So it was good. Didn't feel long, except for the days that were around 20 hours. Those were harsh. Thank you.
Hi. I was wondering, did you get to meet Tyler and Josh?
Oh yes, I was just in the car with them. Both. Wait, what did you say?
The band members from 21 Pilots.
Oh no, I thought you said the Weasley twins. I was like, yeah, I was just in the car with them. That was great. No, I didn't get to meet them, unfortunately. I'm sorry.
Tyler and Josh, Oliver and James.
Two names, I think that's what it said. Probably. Yeah. Hello.
How was it like to work with the rest of the Suicide Squad?
It was a ball. Every day was super spontaneous, and you know, there were pranks pulled by the Joker and Boomerang, and it was just, every day was different. So I didn't know what to expect, and that made it so much fun for the 6 months that we were shooting.
Thank you. Was there a part in the Suicide Squad you found the most difficult to perform or like film?
I think some of the hardest scenes were the scenes in the hurricane. So the final battle was shot with huge wind machines coming at us, and it's not in the movie, but there was a scene where I had to run up these stairs facing these huge fans with hurricane water coming at me, and I was running, and I realized that I was stepping into place
on the floor,
and I wasn't actually moving forward. It was that the rain was that heavy, and the wind was pushing me back so far that I couldn't step forward. I think those days were the hardest because we were shooting in icy cold water, so that the, you know, we can't use warm water or hot water for any of those scenes because the cameras would fog up. So the water is cold, and we're shooting, 12 to 18 hour days in that rain, and the scene lasts for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. So I think those were the hardest physically.
Thank you so much.
Hi. I'm just wondering, like, with all the sets, were they mostly covered with green screens and stuff?
Good question. No, they were not. We got very lucky. David really likes to put his actors in as much reality as he can. So a lot of the sets were made so that little was left to the imagination. I think most of our scenes were without green screen. So it really helps the actor. He's a great director.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Hey, I was just wondering, for your role, did you go through a decent amount of sword training, and what was that like?
Yes, definitely. I went into pre-production in March, at the beginning of March, and I practiced every day, even during shooting. I think all of us were training together, and you know, some of us had different training. I obviously had sword fighting, and Margot had an array of things. So she had to be a gymnast and use a rope and also use a bat and a gun. So we all had different training, but sometimes we would spar together. Martial arts we did together. And for me, the sword fighting, I felt that if I didn't know everything by muscle memory, I wouldn't be able to do katana justice, because she is this martial arts expert, and she doesn't have to think about every move. It's just instinctual, and I needed to get to that point in order to play the character. So that stunt training was one of my favorite parts of building the character.
Thanks.
Thank you.
How many years have you been training martial arts for?
I started karate in middle school. I was doing it for about 6 years, 5-6 years, and then I went off to college, so I couldn't get to all the dojos. But yeah, 5 or 6 years, and I used to train in the forms division of karate, not so much the sparring, because I got my ass beat one time.
Thanks very much for coming along and
helping
showing up to us.
Thank you for having me. I'm so surprised that there are people here. Such a weird thing for me still. It's surreal. Thank you.
Just following on from what the young gentleman said about the green screening, do you find that sometimes it's difficult to figure out exactly what you're doing if there isn't people around you? And a follow-up from that would be, do you find that you end up shooting an awful lot of things that didn't get used or weren't out of sequence, so it was very confusing when you're doing the acting to figure out exactly where things are going?
When we were shooting green screen?
And you know the things that you were shooting things and maybe out of sequence or out of order, so you weren't quite sure what the finished product was going to be as you're working through until it's like all together.
Yes and no. I obviously had read the script so many times, I knew it through and through. But there are certain things like special effects. A lot of Cara Delevingne's Enchantress was done in post. And so I wasn't sure what that was going to look like. I knew what the sequence of events were going to be, but I didn't know what caliber. Funny story. There was a scene in the movie where all of our weapons are taken away, and it's in the last sequence. The hurricane is coming, and Enchantress, we're all fighting Enchantress, and we couldn't decide on how big our reactions needed to be when our weapons were taken away, because David had said, okay, and then 3, 2, 1, the weapons are taken away, and you just react. And we were thinking, okay, all right, but you know, you don't know how violently the weapons are being taken away, or if it's just it's out of my hand, and where did it go? It's hard. So Jay and I were both doing very minor reactions. We're like, oh, it's gone. And then Margot was doing something that was like, oh. So we watched the monitors right after that take, and we all laughed so hard. We had them replay it over and over and over again because it was like the worst acting we've ever seen ourselves do. And then we had to reshoot that whole thing again. But yeah, it's hard to imagine sometimes when you are working against a green screen, or if you have to imagine something. But in terms of David's shooting, he tried to make everything as real as possible. So it was good, I think.
Thank you.
Hello.
How did it feel when you were acting with Will Smith?
It was incredible. I mean, he's just been in the business for so long. I couldn't believe it when I got the role and heard that Will Smith was going to be in the movie. I had seen Will Smith Focus a year before, but he's just the most welcoming, most warm, down-to-earth person. You would think a man to that caliber would, be mean or think other people are beneath him, but it's not like that at all. He's just so nice, and he's also very funny. He raps on set. And he could tell when the crew members and even the cast were getting tired from a long day or, week or shooting for 6 months at the end of it. It kind of gets, like, we need a little bit of a,
let's do this in order to get the energy going, and that's when Will comes in to beatbox on set to lighten the mood, or he, one day we have random ice cream and coffee catering, and we find out that Will was the one that brought it in. You know, it, so he's a really great guy, and I'm glad I got to work with someone like that, because now I know what I want to be in the future, you know, to other people.
So good looking, talented, funny, and generous.
Yes, there's got to be something. Yeah, there's got to be something. I heard that before Focus, he wasn't able to swim. So that was his one weakness. However, Margot taught him how to swim, and now he knows how, so.
Well, it's not surprisingly shrimp.
Hi, I was just wondering what your craziest moment on set was.
Craziest moment on set? Yes, Jack ran around the set naked, completely naked. Yes, I feel like I've told that story so many times, but I'll tell it again. So Jai was in his trailer taking a shower, and he had a towel around his waist, and he came out of the shower, and David, he just popped into his trailer and said, "Hey Jai," as he usually does, and Jai immediately drops the towel and does the Terminator run all around the set, like running, chasing David. And mind you, this is Pinewood Studios. It's not a small set with just a small amount of crew members. It's like 100, 200 people, you know, working on set. And he's just going full on. It's the most hilarious thing. We have a video of it. And it will never...
I'm going to play for you now.
Yes.
No, but he's just the funniest, most spontaneous, kooky Australian guy I've ever met.
We say that he's very similar to Boomerang. Yes. Not much character building here.
Yes, thank you. Hi.
Hi.
My question is about the stunt in the chopper. Yes, going around.
Oh my goodness.
Yes.
I'm so happy you
were
followed.
You having as much fun as Margo was?
Yes, I like rides. I'm scared of heights, but I can do roller coasters as long as it's not like a free fall. But that scene, it was the, you know what? It was the final take after filming for 6 months in Toronto. We did reshoots later on, but it was funny because they said, okay, this is the last scene. All we're gonna do, all you have to do is get strapped onto this thing, and we're actually gonna turn it like a. It was real. It wasn't that the camera was turning; it was we were turning. And some people didn't like it. I won't be you, but some people were.
Oh, go on,
thing. Oh,
yeah. Go on.
I think Will and Ottawali were a bit scared.
I've seen an interview with Joel when he's like, yeah, Margo was like laughing the entire time.
Yes, Margo was so funny. Yeah, she was, you know, laughing. I don't know if it was her laughing or if it was Harley Quinn laughing. But she was like, ah! Yeah. Oh, and then, yeah, probably. And then for me, I had to stand and do that shot. So everyone else got to sit and they were strapped in. And then David says, "Karen, you're gonna be standing here." And I said, "How?" So I was strapped in around the waist to the back of a Chinook. And I had to hold really tight with my hands and my feet so that I would pin straight. And then I would bend this leg, so it was kind of like this. So it looks like I have control, but really I'm just like really straining to kind of hold myself there. But I have a lot of fun shooting that. I'm happy I loved that scene. Hi.
You mentioned before about the running upstairs not making the cut, and other actors have talked about some backstory stuff that didn't make it. And was there anything you did that didn't make it to the actual release that you maybe wanted to see in there?
You know, I obviously had a couple scenes that didn't make the movie, but after watching the movie, I felt that it didn't need to be in it.
Of course, I want to be selfish and say, oh, I want to be in the film more, I want to see more of Katana. But I think for the overall flow of the movie and the point it was trying to make, I don't think they were actually necessary.
You talked before a bit about Jared Leto running around naked on set. Is there anything else?
No, not Jared. Jai.
Oh.
I need to correct that because I'm going to get in trouble if I say anything incorrect. Jai Courtney.
Right. Well, is there anything else that you did on set besides that that you're allowed to tell us today? Just anything to annoy people on set besides the running around naked.
Oh, so in the movie we have a bar scene, kind of towards the middle end and before the final battle, and that was another long, long day of shooting and very emotional, and it was a hard scene to shoot, especially for Jay Hernandez and Will and Joel. But during that scene, we all take a certain kind of alcohol, whatever we choose. I chose whiskey to make the movie, anyway. whiskey. And Margot decided to switch out one of Will's water shots to something real. So it's a serious scene. It's not a party scene. Everyone's serious and is, to honor among thieves, and then he takes a shot, and it's been water the entire day. This is like 8 hours in to shooting the same thing. And he just spits it right back out. He goes, bah! I think that was a funny Harley Deadshot moment. I get that question a lot, and I'd love to be able to say, I got to know Jared really well on set, but I didn't. I only met the Joker, because he stayed in character throughout. Every single time I met him, he would do the Joker laugh, and then he would say, hi, pretty, or, hi, Katana. So I didn't get to meet him really in person until CinemaCon this year. This year, in April. And then I found out that he's a really nice guy. So, such a surprise, isn't it?
Yeah. Hi. I was wondering what it was like working with Cara Delevingne, and were any pranks pulled on set by the cast?
Yes. Cara is one of a kind. I've never met someone so special like her. She is such a free spirit, and there's not really a word to describe her. She's an animal of her own. And, everyone wants to hang out with her because you know that she's the life of the party, on set, at dinner, everywhere. And she's also just down to earth and super nice as well. So I had so much fun hanging out with her. I went to New York with just her during filming to audition for something in New York. So we were filming in Toronto and shooting till what, 7 in the morning? And then we took a plane out to New York, did the audition, stayed there for what, a matter of 3 hours, flew back, and then we had the wrap party that night. So I got to know Cara a little better during that trip. And she has so many interesting ideas. She's a strong, independent woman, and I love her.
Thank you. Hi, I was just wondering if some of the things that Jared Leto did while he was in character, like sending a dead pig to the cast, was that true?
Yes, it was all true. It's so funny because everything actually happened to us. So we talk about it like it's an everyday experience now, but when people hear about it, they're like, oh my god, what did he do? He sent a dead pig, he
gave us weird gifts. What else did he do? He gave Margot a live rat. Yes, we named him Rat Rat. He also gave her a pet snake. She named him Pinky, I think. Yeah, Margot was such a good sport about it too. She, I guess it's the Aussie in her. She was down to have it all, and she thought all the animals were cute. I definitely would not have.
Thank you. If you could change anything about Katana, like out of anything in the world, what would you change it to?
I would take her husband out of that sword.
Yeah, I think a lot of pain would, you know, be released if she wouldn't have to deal with that.
Yeah, I think that definitely.
If you did take the husband out of the sword, though, what would like their storyline be?
Ooh, good question. I'm not sure. Do you think that maybe she'll be living a normal life, though? I'm not sure. I'm not sure if she'd still be fighting and going into battle if she had a happy life with her kids and her husband.
Just a normal happy life.
Yeah.
But in a weird twist, her husband is now possessed the body of a hearing MC, though, again.
Can you imagine? You're like, I'm actually right here.
Thank you.
I just wanted to know, like, about your life. Like, what were you doing before you were an actor?
What would you like to know?
Like, what were you doing before you were a professional actor? Like,
well, so Suicide Squad is actually my first movie.
Yeah,
before booking this, I was doing a lot of auditions, taking a lot of classes, but I only got serious about this industry.
Oh, I mean, like, your job? Like,
my job.
Movie cinemas.
Yes, I was from 8th grade. I was working on a show on Disney called Movie Surfers, and then after that show ended, I started working on a sports show that aired in Japan all throughout college, and I went to UCLA, studied sociology, minored in theater, and then upon graduation, I kind of hit a wall. I didn't know what I wanted to do with my life, and a lot of my friends, you know, were already successful in getting jobs in career fields that they were passionate about, and I started to panic. But when it all came down to it, I realized that I needed to follow my passion and take the courageous leap, because if not now, when?
And like, how did the get in that Suicide Squad? Like,
oh, I auditioned.
All right.
Yes, I auditioned, just like everyone else. Yes.
So is it that he phones you up and says that you got this
chance
to audition, or is it just a, oh, it's a listing from an audition?
No. I think there are multiple ways to do it, but for me, I didn't have an agent, and I only had a management team with me, but she got me the audition, and
what's the difference? Sorry.
Yeah, so an agent gets you a lot of auditions, and they kind of, they're more general, and managers work closely in relation to your career. So they're the ones to advise you on what classes to take, where to take your headshots. Sometimes they get you auditions, like my manager got me Suicide Squad's audition. But they work closely with you. Sometimes they're the ones that book your flights, or you can call them when you break up your boyfriend. Yes.
Go to the side.
Hello. Hi. If you could play any superhero, who would you like to play?
Batman. Batman. I would be the world's smallest Batman. Yes.
Hi.
So, my actual question.
Yes.
When you've worked so hard on a movie and it releases and it has mixed reviews, What does that make you think as an actor? Do you take the reactions on board yourself, or do you just leave it to the wind?
No, obviously we heard about the reviews, we knew about them, but you know, we didn't make it for the critics. We kind of wanted our DC Hero fans to enjoy it. So I think for me, I can't speak for everyone else, but when the reviews came out, the only reason why I was nervous was because I thought, oh, maybe do they share the same opinion as the fans? And that all we want is to make the fans happy. So I was nervous that the fans wouldn't like it. But I've gotten so many comments and so many lovely words here at this convention and others around the world saying, we love the movie, we want to go watch it 2-3 times. I'm going to be Harley Quinn for Halloween. So I think that uplifted my spirits a little bit. Yes, thank you.
Hi. This is like a narrative question. It's like before the bar scene, it's when like all the Suicide Squad finds out that it's a suicide mission. They all go, like all the bad guys go into the bar. I feel like it's really awkward when like after that, there's like an awkward scene where like Katana follows them. Like it feels like really awkward because you're like, well, Katana's like the good guy, and then like she just like follows all the bad guys into the pub. Like I didn't really understand what the director was trying to do again.
So that was a really emotional turn for Katana, I think, because what Joel Kinnaman's character Rick Flagg did was dishonesty. You know, he never told the squad what they were really in for. And, you know, throughout the first two encounters, the first two battles, and until that point, we've created a sort of, how do you say it, like almost like an army mentality or a team mentality. In the beginning, we're all in it for ourselves, but throughout the movie, as we go through the battles, we start to protect each other. And then we find out that he was lying to us the entire time. And so I think at that moment, it's not that I wanted to follow the bad guys. It's not that I chose bad versus like the villains versus Rick Flagg. It was just Katana was hurt that someone she had followed and stayed so loyal to had betrayed her in that moment.
Okay, so like, I didn't realize that she didn't know the...
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Yeah, so thank you.
I just thought you wanted a drink.
Maybe. I think partly.
Hi, I was wondering if you could choose to be any other member of the Suicide Squad, who would you be?
My answer changes so much, so frequently. I think it would be so much fun to play Boomerang. Although the Aussie accent will have to be changed into like a Japanese one or something. But I think it'd be fun because he's so different from Katana. On set, it was so hard for me to stay stoic and stay straight and not laugh at any of the jokes that Harley Quinn or Boomerang were throwing around. You know, there were a couple takes where they'd say something and I just have to hold it in, and then some would leak out of the hopefully nobody noticed. But yeah, so in that way, I like to play a character that's very different from Katana and more playful. So Boomerang or maybe even Harley.
Thank you.
Hi. The scene where you talk to Sword, what were you thinking to make yourself say, like, sad?
You know, I wasn't thinking I have to make myself sad, but that scene, it was actually not in the script, the original script. David came up to me 20 minutes before we shot it. He goes, I have this page for you. I want you to read it
translate it, memorize it, we're shooting it in 20 minutes. And I was like, what? In the original, I wasn't even meant to take off the mask at all. But it was a really stressful moment because I had to translate it, and I'm not a professional translator.
So you don't know, you can't speak Japanese fluently?
I speak it fluently, but the language he uses and the hierarchy, you know, in Asian languages, a lot of it has to do with, yes. And sometimes it's hard translating anime comic book language. Yeah, you're like, I've never said that in my life. Like, some of the, like, moves that Naruto uses, and you're just like, whoa, what does that mean? So it was difficult, but I was able to do it. And I got lucky because in the scene, I'm basically saying, you know, I will join my husband in the sword. And that's something that I had kind of thought about on my own as well. I was thinking, you know, why live this painful, miserable life by myself? Why can't I just take my own life and join my husband in the sword instead of trying to take him out? So it's something that I had discovered previously on my own, and I'm glad I did, because I had 20 minutes to tap into that and release it.
Cool, thank you.
Thank you. Hi. Okay, two questions.
Yes.
First, do you think the movie sucks?
No! No, never!
Okay, just being plugged. And also, so in this continuity, where was Batman, Flash, who else was there in this universe, Cyborg, where were they when this potentially world-ending disaster is going on? So where were they?
I have no idea. You asked them. We really needed them. We really did.
You had it coming.
If you were in any movie, what would you want the director to call it?
Oh, in any movie.
Oh my god, such a hard question.
I would want it to be called Bloopers. And I want it to show it wouldn't just be about one main character, but it would be about multiple main characters, and it would just show parts of people's lives that nobody sees. Because I think nowadays, with social media especially, Instagram, Twitter, we always see everyone's perfected life, their perfect friends, their perfect piece of food, or perfect travel accommodations. You know, it's just, everything has to be perfect, and I think that because of that, sometimes we feel bad about ourselves, you know? Sometimes I find myself alone in bed, just watching a movie by myself, and I think, why didn't I go out with my friends tonight? I could have, but I just didn't. Or maybe I couldn't have, maybe I don't have a friend. I don't know, it's just some downward spiral. So I think it would be really fun to show a movie where we show everyday people and what people do every day and how grateful we need to be in those moments, you know, just...
I don't know if you understand what the word bloopers means.
Well, bloopers... Oh, I get... But
no, I
wouldn't
go to bloopers, the character, the horror story, but...
Yes. I guess I don't. I guess I... No. I could... Because it's about the outtakes of your life.
Okay. But
the
mistake of...
The not-so-glamorous.
They're usually funny, though. Not tragic, like stay at home alone. Watch a movie and be face. Well, just not, there's nothing wrong with that. It's fine.
You
my mom says I'm good looking.
You don't do that? Is it just me?
Yeah, no, I do it all the time. Okay. Although, actually, picking up the dog. Yeah. Oh, that's fine. Actually, just, I'm just gonna jump in here now. I'm a completely different tack. I read somewhere that you used to be here with. You're right? You know any option?
I just got this ring.
Yeah.
It's a manuka flower.
Oh, lovely.
Yes, probably in a souvenir shop.
I read something that you used to be heavily involved in cappella singing.
Ah, yes.
Are we like a Pitch Perfect sort of scenario, or...?
Yes, when Pitch Perfect came out, it was
Well, so I did an acapella for 4 years in college, and I'm definitely scared of singing solos. So I just stayed in the back and I did the beatbox and the doo. But I had so much fun doing it. I was a part of a group called Medley's Acapella, and we were a community service-based acapella group. So in, you know, we would, in Pitch Perfect, you see the glamorous collegiate teams competing with each other. Of course, we've competed, but our main focus was, you know, singing to patients in the hospital, women's shelters, homeless centers, retirement homes, all of that. So it was a really, really, really good experience in my college career, and I think it's shaped a lot of who I am today.
Excellent. And you went with the goal for Pitch Perfect 4 on
Earth? Yeah. It's hilarious because Pitch Perfect, when I came out, we were like, oh, finally, an acapella movie. And, you know, I've seen, what's that group called? It starts with a P. Pentatonix, yeah. And I'm obsessed with them. I can't remember. Superfruit? Do you watch them? Yes, amazing. I saw them live, literally 5 feet away, because they were doing a workshop. So, you know, we've known them from the beginning. and we really do use the word aca for everything. Like, oh, that's acatastic. Yeah, that's a good one. That's good. And the most used one is Aka Destiny. So we have auditions auditions, and then we don't get certain people, and some groups get other types of people, and we're like, well, she just wasn't in it for our Aka Destiny, you know? And we just blame everything on that.
Oh, good God.
It's great.
Sorry.
Soundtrack. I was just wondering what your favorite song from the soundtrack is. Ooh. The 21 Pilots one is a good one. Sorry, I'm blanking on the name. Kehlani? Yes. I listened to the soundtrack before watching the movie at the premiere, and I love the song. It was angelic and it had a beat, it was great. And then I watched the that scene where Gangsta was played, and it was just so perfect that I got chills. Like she Harley falls into the vat, and that's when they cue the music in. Oh, it's perfect. I love it.
Hi.
Hi.
First of all, I just
want
to say good
as
we're doing sociology.
Oh,
I think
are
you as well?
Yeah,
I'm
going to be with you. Awesome, yeah.
Oh, just met us.
Everything is socially constructive.
I
know. So my question is, so now that you've done Suicide Squad, what's next for you? Am I to take a break or did any other projects you want to do? I just can't talk about it yet. It's just, I know, it's just like
an
NDA thing, but I will let you know as soon as I can tell you.
She has stuff.
Martial arts. Kung Fu, okay.
I'm between primary and high school, so yeah.
Yeah, no,
we can have
yes, we can fight each other. Friendly fighting. Yeah. Come to my booth, please.
Is your Kung Fu stronger than her karate?
Yes. We will have to see.
What?
Hi, since you mentioned that you were an acapella group during college, I was wondering what song you liked singing the most and performing. And can you give us a sample?
No sample. You remember, I don't like solo singing.
Did you not hear Big Bob Boop? That was just.
I really liked singing Skinny Love by Bon Iver. That was my favorite, yeah. That was my favorite.
Yay! Hi! what's your view on like the life in Japan? Have you ever thought about going back and doing Japanese cinema, or do you prefer the sort of Hollywood lifestyle?
Such a good question, thank you. So before I got serious about acting and I'm born and raised in LA, so I've grown up there, luckily, because business is there. But before I sat down and started taking classes and was serious about it, I spent about 3 or 4 months in Japan after graduation, trying to see if I liked it there, because I have grown up, you know, living this double life where I come back home and it's pretty much Japan in my household. And then over the summer, I would be in Japan during summer break for 3 months at a time. So it's my second home. And I figured, oh, well, this is probably the best time to figure out whether it's for me to live there. Ended up not liking it, but I think a lot of that had to do with the fact that I had to commute to work an hour on the train during rush hour, an hour there, I didn't have any friends, and then an hour back to my grandma's place where I was staying. And so I didn't like that lifestyle, and I think the Japanese work life is very difficult. You know, you have to work late, and that is normal. It's not amazing that you're working late. It's like, oh, well, today you're here till 11. You're gonna miss your train. That's fine. We'll get a hotel for you. It's like that.
And it's like a 7-day work week for them as well.
Yes, yes. So I think that wasn't for me. But I love living in Japan. The food is great. The people are great. Everything's clean. In terms of the industry, I would love to be. You know, that's my dream. I want to be able to work in both countries because I don't think you see that very often. The only person that comes to mind right now is Ken Watanabe. He's the only one that is doing Inception and also movies in Japan, and I don't think there's a female version of that. So hopefully, one day, I will be the Ken Watanabe of this day and age.
Good luck for that. Hope you do.
Thank you.
Hello?
Hi. During the scene where you're like kneeling down talking to your sword, do you remember the lines in Japanese?
No.
Okay. That's my favorite scene, by the way.
Oh, thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
Just want to say hope you're enjoying your time in New Zealand.
I love
the movie. Just wondering, on the last day, were you able to keep or take any souvenirs, or maybe did you walk off with the katana and be like, bye guys?
No, I was too scared to just like walk off with it because it's such a precious thing. And I asked for the mask, and there's only one mask. We've made several replicas of the entire outfit. There's multiple swords. But there's only one mask because it's really hard to make one that's the right polish and the right materials and the fit. So there's only one, and David has it, I think, with him dear to his heart so that nobody takes it or gets lost. So I asked for the mask and I got a replica, one of the replicas of the mask, and I gave that to my stunt coordinator, Richard Norton, because he was my mentor throughout the shooting. I felt like it would be special to him, or to give to him. I also got the jacket. Yes. I got the stunt jacket because I spent most of my memorable days in that stunt jacket doing all my action scenes, and I felt like that was the one that I wanted. And then I tried to get the sword, but then I realized I don't know how to take it through TSA. So I didn't take that. Well, I know, I should have.
Hi. I'm just wondering if you were a comic book fan before getting involved in the movie.
I was not. I mean, obviously I love the Batman movies. Heath Ledger's Joker and that was, Dark Knight is amazing. But no, I wasn't a comic book reader before, only after. But I was kind of a manga, shoujo manga,
anime kind of gal.
Did you read any Katana stories before as part of researching for the part?
Yes, researching for the part, yes, but I didn't know before my audition. Yes.
Hi, my friend Siren isn't here, but she loves Suicide Squad, so I was wondering if you could say hi.
Yeah, what's her name?
Siren.
Siren.
Hi, Siren!
The characters are really good, so I was wondering how similar is the cast of the characters that you like?
Ooh, I think most of us are very different. We've got some interesting villains in there, so it'd be scary if we were similar, right? I think most of us are very, very different. Aside from Boomerang, maybe. and you know, it's so surprising because Jay Hernandez, the guy that plays Diablo, he is the funniest person I have ever met. He's such a jokester, and he just has really great comedic timing. But in the movie, he's not funny at all. He's very different. Will told me that he had a really hard time tapping into Deadshot because he couldn't justify why he would just kill people left and right for money. And he told me that he was able to come to terms with Deadshot when he realized, or he read the book Anatomy of Motive. And in that book, it said, all humans just do what they want to make them happy. And that term happy has a wide range of meaning per person. And so when you find out what your happy is or what your character's happy is, you can justify whatever action you take.
Couple questions. First question, how much of the movie was reshot and how do you think that impacted the movie overall? And second question, who did your tattoo and where is it?
Mario did my tattoo and it's on my ankle and it hurt. Yeah, you can't see it. It's amazing. Has anyone gotten those tattoos that you can get here at the con? Nobody? Yeah, you got one. What did you get? Ooh, cool. Oh, you got one too. Yeah. Wow. Did it hurt? Yeah, I... Mine took 10 minutes to do, and Margo did it, and she... It hurts so much. It hurts so much. I don't think I can do it yet. Your other question was about... Reshoots. We shot a lot of the end battle over again. The script changed for that, so... that was different, and we added, Katana's entrance scene, which was not in the original script. So her fighting the Yakuza bosses, that was something that was added during reshoots, and I'm so glad that we went with that, because otherwise we would have not seen anything from Katana's backstory. Yeah. Thank you.
And this will be our last question, so they appreciate it.
Okay. So I just want to know, so you know how the term banana is used for Asians that are sort of Asian but born overseas in like a white country?
Bananas?
Yeah, because they're yellow on the outside but white on the inside.
Oh, okay. That's so funny.
Yeah.
In New Zealand you call it banana. In America we say Twinkie.
Yeah, makes sense. Yeah. So I just wanted to know, like, does that make the country successful in America, or what is that like?
What question? Is not with a racist one?
Well, I thought that was okay because I'm Asian.
So.
Oh, wait,
it's alright, babe.
That's right.
To be honest, I have to get everything tailored because I'm 5'2", and usually smaller than most people. And I tailored it too tight, and now it's really, I can't eat anything. But thank you.
Well, from racism to fashion, I think it's a perfect way to end the panel.
Oh, God.
I'm so sorry.
It's fine.
Hey, all of this fantastic to be here, Karen. Thank you very much.